Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saver here from Skew the Script. Today's lesson covers experimental design. Are we looking at a particularly brilliant experiment that investigates whether hiring discrimination is behind gender gaps we see in the STEM field? Let's skew it. Today we're discussing experimental design. This is lesson 4.3 in our course sequence. This lesson was inspired by the good folks at Advanced High School Statistics. Today we're going to be talking about gender gaps in STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. But I want to name something right off the bat. We only have good data on folks who identify along the gender binary, male and female. There needs to be more data collected on those scientists, people working in STEM, who don't identify by this binary. So while we'll be talking about inequalities along the binary lines, there's a more insidious inequality here in that we don't have good data. And we need to have future generations of statisticians fix that issue. So that's one thing I want to name right off the bat. So along the gender binary lines, if you look at the percent of all science paper authors who were male or female, 65% of them were male and 35% were female. There's a serious gap there. This gap is particularly wide in certain fields like engineering, physics, and math. And closer to home, this gap in the workforce is huge for data science. 85% of data science workers, according to a survey in 2020, is male. And this is an issue that I, as a statistics teacher, take very seriously. I have students of all genders who have amazing capabilities and who want to pursue statistics and data science in the workforce. And the fact that this gap is so stark and so present is something that I do a lot of thinking about. And we want to investigate the causes of this, what's driving this, and how can we fix it? So today's lesson is it possible to find the true cause of these gender gaps in STEM? If you want to follow along using guided notes, please go to the URL listed here. Today we're going to first talk about observational studies versus experiments, and then talk about a specific experiment in particular. Last unit, we talked a lot about correlation does not equal causation. We know that for sure, and that applies to this data set as well, so we need to be careful when we're talking about causes. What causes the gender gap? Well, there's one possible cause, maybe hiring discrimination. Specifically, it could be that discriminatory practices in research and industry hiring in STEM cause fewer women to enter or succeed in the field. That is one potential explanation for the gaps that we see. However, from this observed data alone, we cannot prove that gender or hiring discrimination along gender lines is the true cause. Why? Well, there are potential confounding variables. Confounding variables provide alternative explanations for trends between explanatory variables, in this case gender, and response variables, in this case hiring rates. So let's look at one possible confounding factor, confounding variable, socialization. It could be the case that many girls at a young age aren't encouraged to pursue STEM subjects. That could be in school, culturally, it could be in the home. And so fewer women choose to pursue STEM as adults. Flip side of that is we tend to foster boys' belief of their talent in STEM. Again, in schools, in our culture, at home. And so more men then choose to pursue STEM as adults. So what's the true cause of this trend? Is it hiring discrimination? Is it socialization? Is it a combo of one and two? Is it other causes mixed in? We don't know just from this observed data alone. Maybe we can test it though. So let's look at the limits of what we can test. First, talk about observational studies. Those are studies in which data is collected without imposing any treatments. And there are two types of observational studies. There are retrospective studies that examine existing data on individuals, and then prospective ones that follow individuals into the future. Observational studies cannot show cause and effect. They do not control for the confounding factors, so they cannot show cause and effect. So let's look at the study of these gender gaps we've done so far. Have we tried to influence individuals in any way, imposing treatments on them? We have not. We've just studied existing data, observed data. Are we tracking individuals in the future? No, we're analyzing existing data right now. So this is a retrospective observational study. Just looking at these trends right now in gender gaps is just being observational and retrospective. We cannot show cause and effect through the analysis we're doing right now. However, let's talk about experiments. Experiments are studies in which treatment is imposed or forced upon subjects. If an experiment is well designed, you can show cause and effect by controlling for confounding variables. So if we're trying to investigate whether hiring discrimination is the leading cause of these gaps, how can we test this? How can we design an experiment for it? Well, we're going to talk about it using a real experiment that was done at Yale. So a group of researchers at Yale designed an experiment to test for hiring discrimination in labs, in science labs. And we'll discuss a simplified version of what they actually did. You can read the paper listed here for the full version. So what these researchers did is they collected application materials and they made a fake set of application materials. It was application materials for a lab manager position, and the applicant that they made, that was a fake applicant, was a pretty good candidate, but not amazing. So it was very much up to the person doing the hiring to see if they would hire them or not. And they created many copies of these application materials, changing only one thing about them. The only thing they changed, can you catch it here, is the name. Either they got the name John or the name Jennifer on the application materials. And these names were pre-tested by the researchers to make sure they're equivalent in likability and recognizability. And they found 127 lab science faculty throughout the United States, and they assigned them to either get or sent them either a set of John application materials or a set of Jennifer application materials for what they thought was a potential real candidate for a lab manager position at their university. And so at the end, they took the ratings of each candidate from these faculty, and they took the salary estimates and they compared them across the Jennifer and John groups. So in this case, we're going to talk about the components of the experiment here. The experimental units are the individuals or subjects that are assigned different treatments. In this case, it is the lab science faculty that receive either a treatment of the John resumes or the Jennifer ones. The explanatory variable is the variable that is purposely manipulated. It's also known as a factor. In hiring study, the variable that is manipulated is the applicant's name, Jennifer or John. The treatments imposed are the different levels of the explanatory variable in the experiment. Different levels of the explanatory variable are either Jennifer or John. And the response variable is the measured outcome, but that you compare between the groups. In this case, it's the hireability rating and the salary estimate from these faculty. So let's talk about the principles of experimental design and how they're used by the researchers in this study. There are four principles of experimental design: comparison, random assignment, replication, and control. We're going to talk about each one today. Comparison. So we're going to have two groups here, a John and Jennifer group, and we're going to compare results at the end. So we're comparing at least two treatments. That is here. That's one of the essential components. Second one, random assignment. So let's think about a way we could do this. Say that, you know, the science faculty were from two types of universities, tier one universities, so the top universities in the country, or tier two universities, the second highest tier of universities in the country. And we said, okay, let's assign all the tier one university labs or university faculty to get John resumes and tier two to get Jennifer resumes and application materials. When we do that, we have confounding now. We're not sure if it's the gender name on the application materials that's causing differences in hiring outcomes, or if it might be the fact that John got the tougher set of universities here compared to Jennifer. So we've added confounding here. So to account for this, we need to use random assignment. When you assign experimental units to treatments randomly, the ideal situation is which the random assignment balances those confounding factors. So not just tier in this case, if you do random assignment, you're not just balancing tier, but also all the other covariates that might be confounding factors, because you're assigning randomly and not including your own biases in it, you are controlling those confounding factors and balancing them across the groups. So one note here, when we're talking about sampling, as in our previous lessons, if you do a random sample, you reduce bias. In experiments, we do random assignment to treatment, and that reduces confounding. Those are analogous, but you have to use the different languages in those different situations, sampling and experimental language. We need to keep those separated. Now, replication is another principle that we need to think about. Say that we just did this with two faculty members from two different universities, and we did randomly assign them to treatment, either John or Jennifer's set of application materials. When we do that, even if we find a significant difference, it's difficult to tell if it was the explanatory variable, the gender, that was causing the difference in hireability and starting salary, or if it just so happens to be some chance variability in the situation. Maybe one of those faculty members was having a bad morning when reading all the applications, and so that it just that by chance alone, they give a terrible estimate of the hireability to one person. We need to have more people involved. So replication is the idea that you have a large sample size, large set of experimental groups in your study. So they found 127 faculty members at different universities, and they randomly assigned them to receive one of the treatments. And with the larger treatment group size, we reduce the likelihood of differences arising to chance alone. In other words, it makes our estimates of treatment more precise, the treatment effect more precise. Finally, they had control. We controlled for confounding factors. One way to control for confounding factors is by making the application materials completely identical. They made everything about them completely identical. The resume, maybe the letters of recommendation, whatever it was, except for just the explanatory variable, which was, in this case, the gender of the name. They even controlled for the name's likability. They pre-tested John and Jennifer to have equivalently likable names. So now let's talk about describing how we would conduct this experiment and then look at the results. So this experiment is a completely randomized design experiment. It's where you assign experimental units to treatment completely at random. You can think of this as the simple random sample, the SRS of experiments. It's the simplest but still an effective form of a randomized experiment. So let's describe how you would implement a completely randomized design of this experiment with 127 science faculty members as our experimental units. You might be asked to do this on an FRQ, describe how you would do your experiment. So the key steps here are assign each experimental unit a number, write all the numbers on identical slips of paper, put into a hat and mix well, draw out NT, the treatment group size, number of slips of paper without replacement, and then those corresponding experimental units go to treatment one, do the same thing for treatment two, for however many treatments you have, and at the end, after the experiment, compare the response among the treatment groups. So here's a way we can describe this experiment. Assign each faculty member integer 1 through 127, because there are 127 of them. Write integers 1 through 127 on identical slips of paper, put them into a hat, and mix well, so we're sure we're drawing out randomly. Draw out 63 slips without replacement. So that's about half. Then the corresponding faculty members will receive the John application materials. The remaining will receive the Jennifer application materials. We randomly assign them to get one or the other. And at the end of the experiment, record the faculty members' ratings of applicants' hireability and their starting salary. Finally, compare these results across the two groups. So let's discuss the results they actually found. Here were the results. We saw in this experiment, and what they found at the researchers at Yale, is that the Jennifer application materials received, on average, lower starting salary estimates and lower hireability ratings. Specifically, they received, on average, a little bit more than $3,500 less in starting salary estimates, on average, and about 0.85, almost a 1 point difference in hireability rating on a scale from 1 to 7. And they found that those differences were what we call statistically significant. They were so extreme that they were unlikely to happen by chance alone in the random assignment. We'll talk about statistical significance more later in the course. And since this was a well-designed experiment, we can now infer that these differences were caused by gender bias because we controlled for the confounding factors. So now this brings us to our discussion question. Is the proven gender bias among the faculty in this study enough to explain these large gender gaps we see in STEM? Or might there be other causes as well? What do you think? Please explain your reasoning. That's it for today, statisticians. Have a good one.